All right. Maybe we'll start the next session.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, as promised yesterday, after yesterday's more teaching-oriented lecture, I will show you a bit more interesting stuff today. But still, if you have listened carefully yesterday, it will definitely help you today as well. So the question that I'm trying to answer today, or the problem, is this one here, that we all know that bacteria, microorganisms in general, would very frequently experience changes in their environment. And changes in their environment could be, for instance, changes in what kind of nutrients they get available. And that is the case when we look at microorganisms in their natural environment, for instance, E. coli sitting in our gut, or when we use microorganisms for biotechnological purposes. Well, and questions that we could have here would be, how do bacteria actually ensure robustness given all these changes? Or maybe a bit more specifically, how would bacteria be able to adapt between different carbon sources? Well, and of course, these questions are very global, very generic, and it's probably very difficult to answer them in generic terms. So we said we wanted to focus on a very specific case. And the specific case that we were focusing, we were looking at E. coli, and we were looking how E. coli would adjust its metabolism or itself from when it experiences an environmental change from growing on glucose to growing on acetate. So when E. coli grows on acetate, well, E. coli would take up this acetate, and this is a depiction of a part of the depiction of its metabolic network. It will take up this glucose, funnels it down the Meyoff pathway, and excretes part of it, part of the carbon that it has taken up as acetate again. And once this glucose is depleted, E. coli magically senses that and rewires its whole metabolic operation, now taking up the earlier produced acetate again, and now runs its metabolism in a so-called gluconeogenic manner. So now here it was in this way, and now it goes in the other direction. And apparently this is something that takes time, and if you look at what... Is there actually somebody who knows this person here? Well, not personally, but... So this is Jacques Monod, the founding father of bacterial physiology, and already he has described that when you give microorganisms two different nutrients, that they would first grow fast on the first one, then there's a time, and once the first one is depleted, there's a time when there's apparently no growth, and then they would adjust themselves, and then they would grow on the second carbon source. And that's something that is called a dioxy. You might have heard about this. So this is the example that we wanted to study and wanted to understand how E. coli actually masters this adaptations of flux when being switched from glucose to acetate. Well, and if you would like to address this question, then it's probably good to start with in thinking about what is actually known. Well, and what is known about E. coli is that, well, PubMed is full of E. coli literature. We know its metabolic network. We know its regulatory, large part of its regulatory network. So that's a transcription factor gene interactions. And there's many other interactions known, such as protein-protein interactions, metabolite-protein interaction. And this is just a depiction of the many interactions that were known a few years ago. So lots of things are known. And we not only have this molecular detail here, but we also have lots of data on this organism. So people a few years back have characterized E. coli's omes, yeah, so the transcriptome, proteome, metabolome under different condition. There's lots of transcriptomics data out there. And we ourselves, just a few days ago, have added to this, now that we quantified E. coli's proteome under 22 conditions, really in a quantitative manner. So for any of you who is working with E. coli and interested to get proteome data, I really would like you to refer you to this paper. You will find protein abundances for about 2,300 E. coli proteins quantified under 22 conditions, down to sort of single protein copy number up to whatever copy number it gets. Anyway, so what the key message that I wanted to give you here, we have lots of molecular information about E. coli, we have lots of data, But still, if I show you, refer you to very simple questions such as this one here, this one being, how does E. coli actually sense the presence of a carbon source? Then we start, then question marks start to arise. If I ask you this question in general terms, yeah, what are the mechanisms of how a microorganism would sense the presence or an absence of a carbon source? What would come to your mind? Yeah, a lac repressor kind of thing. So that would mean a transcription factor or a cytosolic protein binding to a nutrient. Yeah, that's probably the paradigm example. What other options would organisms in general have? Sorry? Yeah, trans proteins that are sitting in the membrane and sort of probing the outside, yeah? And then being connected to some kind of signaling cascade. Okay, so these are examples of how how organisms could sense and probe their environment. But if I now tell you that E. coli can grow on more than 100 different carbon sources, what kind of implications would this give if E. coli would use transmembrane sensors, or if E. coli would use sort of lac repressor type molecules? Wouldn't that mean that E. coli would have to have 100 different of those systems in place? Question mark, question mark, question mark. So you're seeing what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to cast doubt on our current knowledge. But I keep on going further. Even if you would know how E. coli would sense this, what would then be actually the concerted action of events that upon a sensed altered environment E. coli would do to really adjust its metabolic fluxes? Yeah. So what is the mechanism of how E. coli just manages such an adaptation? So you see that despite all this knowledge that we have, despite all the data that we have, some very key system type questions are still open. And I would like to ask you, well, if we have these questions, what would be one way to attack them? Yeah, and here I would like to refer you back to this slide that I showed you yesterday. And if you ask yourself, where in this corner, if systems biology would be the tool to attack these questions, where on this slide, which approach on this slide would you gonna choose? Measure more? No, probably not. Yeah, we're definitely, this is what we need. We'd like to get there. We have lots of things here, we have lots of data, so probably it's this part here that is most helpful for us try to answer these questions. Okay, so if we agree that this is the corner where we'd like to work on, so meaning that we would need a model to address this. And step number one in model development, what is that? Data, pathway concentration. What do you say? Space. Well, what I teach my students, before you go and start developing a model, define the purpose of the model. Why is this important? Modeling involves making assumptions. And all these assumptions are only justified in the light of the purpose that you define. So you need to be absolutely sharp on what is the purpose that you would like to achieve with this model? What is the hypothesis that you would like to test with the model? Yeah? So this is step number one. So in the light of the problem that I showed you on the previous slide, what would now be a good statement of the purpose? Or probably the question is too open. Well, I'll probably show you the purpose that we have defined here. Namely, the purpose was to test the following hypothesis. To test the hypothesis whether the adaptation capability that E. coli can show could emerge from the quantitative and dynamic interaction of the known molecular players. The known molecular players are the ones that I just showed you just a few slides ago. All this huge knowledge on E. coli, yeah, on small molecule protein interactions, on pathways. Yeah, could we identify a set of molecular mechanisms on the basis of which this adaptation capability that we observe could emerge? Yeah? So this is a clear hypothesis, a testable hypothesis. Okay? So now this, yes. I'll come back to this individuality thing tomorrow. Today, I'll pretend as if this would not exist. And I will resolve it tomorrow. Will you be okay with that? It is connected, and you will see. And I will come back to that in tomorrow's lecture, the individuality aspect. But let's assume here that every cell would do the same. Yeah, and we would like to, or we could say, we'll just look at an individual cell. We'd like to understand of how an individual cell does this adaptation. But still, this hypothesis would still hold true. Yeah, this hypothesis could still be tested. Okay, so now we have a hypothesis. Step number two towards building a model would now be to choose the right modeling approach, right? So what type of model? Would we need to develop, what type of modeling approach would we need to pursue in order to test this hypothesis? And I'll just give you Jörg Stelling a few years ago, 11 years ago, had came up with a very rough classification in types of models. Yeah, which type of model would you go for? And why? When you mentioned the interaction-based, other opinions? Well, this we defined here, right? This is the hypothesis that we wanted to test. And I would like to draw your attention to this word here. Yeah, and molecular mechanisms. So which one is now the right one?
So one by one and see which one is giving extra features into it. You start with the most basic thing and see what all can you answer by that. And then if you can't answer your question, then you can complicate it by adding the parameters.
But definitely the problem that we're looking at is a dynamic problem. Yeah? So we wanted to see of how an organism, once exposed to an environmental change, would be able to maneuver it from here to here. So what is inherent in the problem is the dynamics. None of these two approaches can be really used to investigate dynamic process, molecular dynamic processes. So at least my point of my entry into this was that we thought that we would need a really differential equation-based model that would describe the dynamic process here. So this is the type of model that we're now going to develop. Okay, so next question is then, and that's the point that few of you have mentioned earlier. So now we would have, it's only now that we start thinking about what would need to be go into this model to describe this process. And now it's about defining boundary conditions and making assumptions. So this is what the process that we would like to understand, how this comes about, how E. coli manages to rearrange its carbon flux. So what kind of ingredients would we have to put into the model? What do we need? Reaction network, rate constants. relationships. And if you now really think about, or if you define relationships a bit further, enzymes, somebody says, well, we have pathways, enzymes. Separation of time scale. So if you actually look at the time scale of this process, what is, well, what would be the time scale when E. coli moves from growing glucose to acetate? Is this, what is the time scale? Is that a matter of seconds, minutes, hours? Minutes, yeah, to maybe even hours until or a few steady state is, the new steady state is reached. So if we go from, yeah, maybe seconds, minutes, hour time scale, what would change here next to the fluxes? Growth rate would change? Amount of proteins, yeah. So we definitely would also need to consider, next to the metabolic processes where we need to have consider enzymes and their kinetics, we probably also need to consider changing enzyme levels, right? Yes. Although we, for simplification reason, we could just say that we just work in a concentration space, so not thinking that a cell would sort of really grow in mass or so. Now, the concentrations would probably not fluctuate. Yes, no, that's true. Question is, if you're now primarily interested in a metabolic process, whether we would need to model the process of DNA replication, yeah, or whether this is something that we could left aside. Yeah? So definitely, you mentioned many of the things that we need to think about. What kind of pathways would we need to include? Gene and protein expression, transcriptional regulation definitely being important. And if we zoom into these global aspects in more detail, yeah, so what kind of reaction would we now include in this model? What kind of pathways would we include? Production of the basic precursors that are required for growth. Yeah, that would probably focus, zoom it in on the central metabolic pathways, such as glycolysis, DCA cycle, and these kind of things. Well, this point here is actually a very tricky one, because we are now about to write down differential equations, and differential equations we would need to write down for each and every metabolite that we include here in these pathways. So if you're ambitious and want to include a balance, if you want to include ATP in this, yeah, so you would have to write down a differential equation dATP over DT equals, yeah, and what is on the right side of the equation? Production terms and depletion terms. So this is going to be a long equation. We're probably, even this blackboard would not be long enough for me to write it all down, right? Because ATP is produced and consumed in so many reactions. And for all these reaction terms, we would have to come up with a kinetic rate expression later. Yeah? So what we did here is we opted to say, hey, we make ourselves blind. We just consider there's a cellular system, a hypothetical cellular system in place that takes care of the fact that ATP is sort of balanced. So we centered the model around just balancing carbons, more or less, with neglecting balancing these two things. Well, the model that the model topology that we came up with was this one here. So this is yet an empty E. coli cell. This is an environment where there's either glucose or acetate present. And the metabolic pathway that we included was just this one here. So you see a very much reduced or lumped part, glycolysis. You see a TCA cycle. You see no pentose phosphate pathway, but what you see is that some of these enzymes here are allosterically either inhibited by metabolites of this network or activated. Yeah, so these are these small letters here. So pyruvate kinase is here activated by fructose based phosphate. So this is what we thought would be the basic, the very, very, very basic pathways that E. coli would need to either metabolize glucose and metabolize acetate. Yeah? But you see, there's lots of things that are not included. Well, something else that we included were transcription factors. And out of the about 150 transcription factors that E. coli has, we included just four. And we included those four that whose activity was either repressed or increased by metabolites of this small metabolic network. Yeah, so there's a few, for instance, this one here. This one, this transcription factor interacts with fructose bisphosphate to form this complex, and then it's inactive. It doesn't bind to the DNA anymore. And here we included processes to describe the gene and protein expression, a lumped gene and protein expression, so we pretended there is no mRNA, so proteins can be produced from nothing and be degraded again, and this production processes would be regulated by these four transcription factors. Yeah, so you see a very simple, rudimentary description of E. coli, probably not covering a percent of the E. coli literature. But that is what we felt could be the most basic things that could be needed. Yeah, and of course, any other modeler might have made different choices. So this is nothing. From nothing, a protein is being produced. And it can also be degraded, so it turns into nothing again. Yeah, so this is just a degradation process. This is a production process.
What are the things above the arrow?
These are these four transcription factors that would either, in this case, repress the production of this, or in this case, it would activate the production of this protein. Well, or you can also, if you like, just remove these two symbols. That's just, these arrows just describe the production of a protein and the degradation of the protein. Yeah, so it's these rates here, these processes describe the lumped gene and protein expression process. Yes, out of the 150 transcription factors, we included those that were whose activity was regulated by metabolites of this small metabolic network that we have chosen. Well, they are, and it turns out that those four transcription factors that are regulated by metabolites of this enzyme are also those transcription factors that regulate the abundance of most of these enzymes. So you see, these are all the enzymes here that are included in this network here. And all these enzymes are regulated by any of those four transcription factors. Clear? OK. So next step here, after we had defined this topology, we had to translate this into equations. So for each of these metabolites here, for each of these proteins, we had to come up with a differential equation. Where on the left side, there's a differential term. And on the right side, there's all the rate expressions, the rates that either produce or deplete the respective compound. So then total gives us 47 differential equations. And for all these rates here, we had to come up with rate expressions that define the speed with which these rates happen. I guess this process is all clear to you. And if you look at this, then this model is fairly big. And until here, it was actually also a fairly simple exercise, but the headache really started here. About 200 parameters, of which many of these parameters even would be just parameters that are parameters for lumped processes. Yeah, so. Where there would have been no chance that we find a kinetic rate constant for a process where we had lumped things together. Yeah, yeah. For some of these rate constants, we could eventually have found values in the literature. But even if you do so, yeah, then they span orders of magnitude in different papers. Yeah, so we had to more or less come away of how we would determine them anew. And then the thing that you would do would be that you would run a parameter estimation. Yeah? So this is a dynamic model. In order to run a dynamic model, to do serious parameter estimation on a dynamic model, we would have needed dynamic data on the dynamic protein expression, dynamic metabolite levels, and ideally dynamically measured fluxes. None of this was really available at the time when we did that. Yeah? So we just had a bit of steady state data available, and everything that we tried to do, using the classical approaches to parameter estimation, using gradient-based methods, using evolutionary algorithms, we miserably failed. And that could be due to the fact that we are not experts in that, or that this problem is simply too big for doing this. And but still, in order to test our hypothesis, and I remind you again, the hypothesis would be, could we find a set of mechanisms that could, from which this adaptation capability could emerge? Yeah? So we needed to get this model to run. But again, this classical parameter estimation, it's just a scheme of how this goes, it shows here, we miserably failed. So we had to come up with something else, and we came up with a more parameter guesstimation approach. And the approach rests on the following idea, that all these rates here, we could actually, in steady state, come back, boil down to the actual rate expressions again, and you will recognize this equation. Well, this is simply the Michaelis-Menten term, where this would be the reaction rate, this would be the substrate concentrations, this would be the concentration of the catalyzing enzyme, and there would be two parameters. And the PhD student who was working on this realized that, hey, there is steady state data available on E. coli when it grows on glucose and when it grows on acetate. And what is actually measured in this omics data, and this steady state omics data, are metabolites at steady state, are fluxes at steady state. Yeah? These are the things that have been measured with the techniques that I showed you yesterday. And also protein levels have been measured at steady state. And if you take these three pieces of information, metabolite levels, protein levels, fluxes, and compare this with this equation, then it turns out that this has been measured at steady state from metabolomics, this has been measured at steady state from proteomics, this has been measured at steady state with 13C flux analysis, or has been estimated with flux balance analysis. Yeah? So when you look at this algebraic equation, you see that we can actually plug in measurements here, and even if you would have two measurements at the two steady states, we could write down this differential, this algebraic equation two times, and then could use high school math to more or less solve it for these two unknown parameters. So the experts in the audience will immediately see that this could be very problematic. Yeah? If measurement is noisy, which it is. Yeah? Furthermore, it could be that even having measurements for two steady states, these two parameters could not be estimated uniquely or so. But still, this was for us a rather practical approach to get some ideas on what parameter values would need it to be. Yeah? So we went through this approach, and we have written down this approach in this paper here, this parameter guesstimation approach. And finally, after a lengthy process, we had a model, meaning that we had some ideas on the parameter values that we could simulate. What I'll show you on the next slide is a result from a first simulation. And what I show you on this slide is what will now happen if you would grow E. coli in a shake flask. And the things that you could observe would be its growth. And you would be able to observe the uptake of glucose and eventually the excretion of acetate. Yeah? So this is when we look at just the physiology of these E. coli cells. And this are the first simulation results that I show you. So this is now simulated data, and what you see here is the substrate concentration that in this case would be glucose, and you see it going down. Yeah, good. What you also see is that you see the biomass to go up. This is this one. Yeah, there it is. Apparently these cells are growing, and you see them producing acetate here. And for those of you who have done these kind of experiments before, you would say this looks pretty much like in real life. Yeah, they consume glucose and produce acetate. So at this point in the simulation, what we did is now you see that once glucose is depleted here, then they start to change their metabolism and now take up the acetate, because this is indicated by the fact that acetate goes down, and they start to grow slower. Yeah, so it's really what a real E. coli would do. At this point, we just added, don't look at this, sorry, just look at this one here. We added further acetate to this in silico cell. We diluted them. They would continue to grow. And here, they would definitely be fully acetate adapted. Yeah, they would have a fully acetate adapted metabolism. And at this point here, to this in silico cell, we now added both carbon sources at the same time. And we were wondering what would happen. Would this now fully acetate-adapted E. coli, would this continue to grow on acetate? Or would it switch back to glucose? And to our surprise, what was really nice to see, indeed, it switched back to glucose, which you can see by it first consuming the glucose, again producing acetate. Only once the glucose is gone again, they would switch back to growing on acetate. So we definitely could say that this model produces the known physiology, which is the production of acetate from glucose and the preferential uptake of glucose over that of acetate. Yeah, so this model does really what the real E. coli cell does. And furthermore, if we now zoomed into the simulated intracellular glucose intracellular metabolite levels, then what we saw is that all compounds stayed within physiological bounds, meaning that they stayed within a concentration level that we also observe experimentally. And this was very good to see, because given the fact how we estimated these parameters, yeah, and I hardly dare to say estimation, given the fact how we came up with these parameter values, I guess it would not have been unexpected that we could have also gotten negative concentrations or so, yeah, but we did not. So they stayed within physiological bounds, which is good to see. So apparently, and now I'm going back to the hypothesis that we have drawn up, apparently the adaptation capability that E. coli has could eventually emerge from the molecular interactions that we have put into this model. Yeah? So this is now the conclusion that connects back to the hypothesis that we had. Apparently, they have found a set of mechanisms, a set of parameter values that would E. coli allow to do this adaptation from growth on glucose to growth on acetate. So you have achieved the first milestone. Say it could be this set of molecular mechanisms.
Is when it adapted, from acetate to glucose, that happened over. In reality, it happened over multiple generations of this. Like in the later generations, basically E. coli switched to it, isn't it? It didn't happen over the same generation.
What would you mean by this generation?
As in, that batch of the E. coli,
yeah,
which was feeding on acetate. When you basically change the medium, let's say it's a mixing medium with glucose being the dominant one. The time scale there is in R, so I would assume that maybe there are next generation of further down, they just switch to this thing. This is a very naive question. Let's say I have a very periodic sort of changing them, periodically I'm changing. So there are periods where essentially glucose is the dominant one and periods where acetate is the dominant one. And that if the frequency or sort of the time scale over which this concentration is changing is, let's say, comparable to the lifetime of these, the dividing time of these things, do they, will there be anything like memory where they realize that, it's probably not worth switching to glucose because it's going to vanish in very short time or something of that sort? Does something of memory... you have a square wave pulse of glucose and acetate. Let's say glucose concentration is short-lived. Glucose is preferred. But let's say short-lived.
Yeah. Can we come back to this question,
sure,
after tomorrow's lecture? Because we'll know more, and then it makes it easier for me to answer this question. Yeah. right now, I would like to keep you on track. So what is important again for you to realize that apparently we have identified a set of mechanism that E. coli can use to make this adaptation. Yeah. Well, and now I would like to come to our very first question and have a look in how could E. coli now actually sense the presence of a carbon source. Yeah. This was the actual question that we started with. And now we took this model. Yeah, so you're asking basically what could be a minimal model that is doing that. And that is something that we have not attempted. But at this moment, we just take our model. And now it's a model that can do this, but we still don't understand of how it really goes, right? So we would now take this model as we have it and try to understand of how this sensing and adaptation capability really emerges. And once we know that, then we could go and make even a smaller model. But at the moment, we just take what we have and sort of try to see through these the working of these mechanisms to really see of how E. coli is doing it. I'm not saying, well, that there could not be an even smaller version. There can probably be a smaller version. But now we just take what we have and try to understand of what's now actually going on. And this I would like to show you on this slide here. We think that once a carbon source runs out, which is, you just saw this running out, and another one was present, that this other one would just flow in through basal protein expression, and it would flow in as long as thermodynamics would permit it. Meaning once this was flowing in, gradients were eventually such that this one could not be metabolized. So this is just what we think is happening in a passive manner. Yeah, that once this one is gone, another one is present, this other one through basal expression would just flow in. But this is not yet how E. coli would sense what is flowing in. And we think E. coli senses what is flowing in by measuring of intracellular metabolic flux. I probably have to remind you again of what metabolic flux was. It had a unit. And the unit was moles per time, so it's a rate. And in fact, what I'm proposing here is that E. coli can measure the rate of metabolic flux. So that E. coli, an organism, can measure a rate. Now you ask how this could be done. How could an organism ever measure a rate? Well, for that, I show you how we measure rates in the technical world. Probably have seen these devices, or this one. This is just a scheme of this one here. These are flow meters. You sometimes see them in hospitals when patients get oxygen blow in their nose, yeah, where the doctor would then turn this valve. And what would happen is that this floater here, yeah, this has a certain geometry. And through the flow rate coming in here, this floater would move up. Because of the flow resistance and the gravity force is dragging it down. If we reduce the flow rate, this floater will go down. So what this little device does is it translates something, namely a flow rate, into a height. So it actually just translates something. I'll show you another example. In the construction area next to our university building, I just a few weeks back saw this pipe, which had a little hole here. And I just connected it to this thing here. So if I turn this open here, what will happen? This fountain will get bigger, right? If I turn it the other way around, this fountain would get smaller. So what this fountain actually is, it tells us something about the flow rate through this one here. So it also translates a flow rate into something that we can measure, namely a height. Did you understand the concepts, how we measure, one way how we could measure a rate in the technical world? And now biology came up with
just a biochemical version of something that is exactly like this. And the way it would work is the following way. You have here enzymes that would catalyze a certain reaction, an intermediate M, a metabolite here, another reaction here. And what if now the enzyme kinetics, the kinetics of these enzymes and their regulation, have evolved in such a manner that the level of this metabolite always strictly follows the flux through this pathway, then this metabolite here would assume the function of this floater. If the flux through this metabolite, through this pathway would low, and this metabolite would be low, yeah, then it would, the floater would be here. If you increase the flux and this metabolite would be high, yeah, then this floater would be high. But in order for that to accomplish, it's really such that these enzyme kinetics and their regulation would have to have certain properties. And I'll show you that too, probably half an hour or so, how this would work. So, and if this metabolite, this corresponds now to the floater, is being coupled, for instance, to a transcription factor, what we then would get, we would get flux, metabolic flux-dependent regulation. And conceptually, all this together, we would call a metabolic flux sensor.
M measuring the ratio of the fluxes that generate and consume?
No, it's steady state. The ratio of these fluxes would be 1. Yeah, so the influx here would correspond to the outflux. But you could use such a system even in a dynamic case, because also here, yeah, if I dynamically make this smaller, it goes down. If I move it up, it goes up again. So, but the idea would be that it's the influx and the outflux would be the same. And the level of this metabolite is more a property of a sort of resistance. And so if you have also here, it's actually the resistance of this tube that increases the pressure and then makes this to go higher. And you have to look at the same way here in the enzyme kinetics. They also have a certain resistance, yeah, which make then this metabolite to go up once the flux that we push through this is being increased. Okay, so the now I'll show you. Yes. No, M is a metabolite. No, there's not a transcription factor for each metabolite. And I would also argue that there's only a few metabolites have the function of being a flux. We call them flux signaling metabolites. There's a few metabolites spread out through the metabolic network that we think have gotten the function of being a flux signaling metabolite. Yeah? I'll show you an example of such a flux signaling metabolite, and this is fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. It's a metabolite, it's a glycolytic intermediate. It sits about halfway through glycolysis. And in E. coli, this represses the transcription factor CRA. And what our model suggested that this metabolite, fructose bisphosphate, would increase with glycolytic flux in this particular manner. And correspondingly, this transcription factor, the activity of this transcription factor would decrease with glycolytic flux. So this is what came out of this very crude model that we had developed. And this was probably a good point where we had to check this experimentally, ask whether this is also true in a real E. coli. So we used a cultivation device that is called a glucose chemostat culture. It's a way how to tightly control growth rates of an E. coli culture. We used 13C metabolic flux analysis to sort of control this variable here, so to control the variable, the flux through the glycolytic pathway. Then we used metabolomics, just in a way that I showed you yesterday, to measure the concentration of this metabolite. And what you can see, that this is fairly good agreement. And we used GFP reporter strains to measure the activity of this transcription factor. So that would correspond to this. And also that, I would say, is in fairly good agreement, given the fact how crude this model actually still is. OK. So this look good. And if, now next we speculated, if this is really a flux signaling metabolite, then this flux signaling and flux-dependent regulation should actually be independent of what kind of carbon source is now funneling into the glycolytic pathway. So we now fed E. coli with different carbon sources that all funneled into glycolysis. And we measured the activity of this transcription factor as a function of the glycolytic flux. And we see that the activity of this transcription factor indeed is just flux dependent and not dependent on any of the carbon sources that would go in, which we took as an additional indication that this is really a flux signaling metabolite and this is is doing flux dependent regulation. Yes. The point is here that this system is just sensing the rate of glycolysis, the flux through glycolysis. It's apparently not sensing any kind of nature of the flux. And I will argue later that it's probably not important for the cell to sense the precise nature of a carbon source, but what is rather important for a cell is to know how its metabolism is doing. And you will see how this makes sense in a few minutes. There was another question.
And one of the things that confused me is that you make a big deal out of the fact that your activity is linear in the flux. Whereas in my impression would be any allosteric regulation is implicitly a flux sensor. It just gives you a nonlinear response, which the transcriptional regulator downstream can decode. Right? I just don't understand the distinction you make between any allosteric regulator and one that, well, at least if I remember the paper right, because it was a couple of years ago or a year and a half ago, is very linear, what you're doing here.
Apparently it is, so this response between flux and activity, so output of this sensor, apparently is linear. Why? I have no idea, but probably there's just most information in this being linear. The second part of your question, if I got it right, you're asking whether any allosteric interaction could do a thing. I think that there's two different types of allosteric regulation. Could we talk about this in the break? Because I think I would have to make a big detour now, but it's an important point. Okay, how do you go back? Okay, so the question that you now might, what I mentioned here, that enzyme kinetics and regulation need to be such to actually make this possible. Yeah, so that this metabolite really follows the flux in here a linear manner. What kind of kinetics and regulation would now need to be in place to make this really a flux signaling metabolite? And that's one of what I wanted to show you in the next few slides. So the question is, how is the flux signal established? And this is the flux signal. This is this metabolite. How is this established and how is this made linear? So we are asking now, this is our output. This is the input. What is the system that does that? And in a way, it's nothing else than we are asking now, what is the geometry of the floater and what is the geometry of this, yeah? Because it's also here this geometry that established the correlation between an input flux and a height. Input flux and a height. Input flux and a height. Yeah? So in this little floater thing, in this flow meter, it is the geometry of the floater and the tube which establishes this relationship. And now we are asking, we have really metabolic flux as an input, and we would like to have this concentration here as an output. And we see that there's a linear relationship. Okay? Problem clear? Now this has something to do with enzymes. And this is a reaction rate, and this is eventually a substrate concentration. So if we talk about enzymes, then we're very quickly at Michaelis-Menten, where here we would have the rate, and here we would have the substrate concentration. and it would look like this. And this is nothing else. If you mirror this on a diagonal, then you have nothing else in here. Yeah? Where this would be flux. So you could say, hey, there is the linear. I saw the linear relationship between flux and a substrate concentration. Right? There it is. But this linear relationship is only there in the range of the Km value. If a cell, okay, so we could say in the range of the Km value, we could get this linear relationship. But what if the cell would change the enzyme concentration of this reaction? What would happen? Well, it would change this. And if there's more enzyme, this would go like this. If there's less enzyme, it would go like this. So that if the cell would establish this relationship between flux and FVP concentration, that just using the linear part of a Michaelis-Menten, then it would make the whole thing dependent. Then it would have to make sure that the enzyme concentration would always be identical. And that's probably something that's very difficult to do. Okay? Furthermore, what we have found in this particular case, and this is why I've indicated the Km range here and the true metabolite concentration, that it turns out that this enzyme that is doing that is not operating here. The metabolite levels that we observe experimentally are here, and the Km is here. So that means that this mechanism does not rely on the Michaelis-Menten part. So what is it then that establishes this linear correlation here? And we have worked this out in this paper, and I'll now walk you through it. So this is what I just showed you. Yeah? The reported Km is here. The reported FVP levels are here. So this cannot do the job. Furthermore, this enzyme, fructose bisphosphate aldolase is actually not a Michaelis-Menten enzyme because it has one substrate, two products, and it's actually a reversible one. You probably remember that in order to derive the Michaelis-Menten, there was this assumption that it's an irreversible reaction. Yeah? So for multiple reasons, this cannot be it. Yeah? So what is it then? So I just told you that this enzyme that consumes FVP is a reversible one. And it would have actually two products, but here for simplification, I just say it has one product. So now we could say we make the FVP concentration. FVP concentration is a function of the flux through this pathway. And because it's a reversible Michaelis-Menten concentration, also the concentration of this product and of parameters. Clear? So now we have a problem. If you now we are looking for a relationship of FVP and flux only, but there's also this part in here. So what we could do is, if we go one step further, go to the next enzyme, we could now write down an equation for the next enzyme where the product concentration of this one here is a function of the flux through this pathway, the product concentration of this one here, and some other parameters. And we could plug in this equation into this one here. But then we have FVP as a function of the flux and the product concentration of product 2. Now we can go to next enzyme, do the same trick again. Now plug in and have an equation where the concentration of this product is a function of the flux through this pathway, the product concentration of this one. And we can plug in this one here. And we can keep on doing this until we hit an irreversible reaction here. This irreversible reaction is now only a function of the product of the concentration of this compound here and flux and parameters. So we have another equation that we can plug in this one here, then this one in here, and this one in here. So we could be able to come up with an equation that relates the concentration of this flux signaling metabolite only to the flux of this pathway and parameters. And this is what we do. If we look into the glycolytic FVP, the next following steps are all reversible steps. And the point where we get to an irreversible point is pyruvate kinase. This is an irreversible enzyme, yeah? Just a few reactions down the road. And we can come up with an equation that gives us here FVP being X as a function of parameters and flux. Yeah? So now we have just replaced one enzyme kinetic by the other and got an expression where we relate the concentration of the flux signaling metabolite with flux and some parameters. And this would actually, if you look at this, these parameters are all constants, this would give us a linear correlation between our flux signal and flux. If we now do that, if we now plug in numbers here, realistic parameters and realistic thermodynamics, whatever we did, whatever numbers we tried, we did not get the linearity beyond the Km value. And this is what we have observed experimentally. Yeah? The relationship between the flux signaling and flux is linear beyond the Km value. So we could not establish this with any combination of reasonable physiological parameters. So apparently there's still something missing in our understanding of how this linear relationship is achieved. And what we have realized at that point is that there's actually, in E. coli, there's a feed-forward activation of fructose bisphosphate on pyruvate kinase. Yeah, so pyruvate kinase is, again, this last irreversible step. We have found that there's a linear feed-forward activation, and only if we use that, then we could come up with physiological reasonable parameter values that could establish a linear correlation between flux as input and the level of this metabolite as output. I'll skip that. So I've just walked you through three steps. So we first ask, could it be an irreversible Michaelis menten that is doing the job? We found out, no, it's not, and it's actually also not a good assumption because this enzyme is not an irreversible one. Then we just replaced all reversible following reactions with each other, but we found that the linearity of the response is not sufficient, but only if we take into account this feed-forward activation, then we get the linearity. And what is actually nice about that, if you do that, what you can show that then this system that is doing this gets independent of the enzyme levels. So if there's just sufficient amount of enzyme present, then it turns out that variations in the enzyme levels could not do anything with this relationship between flux as an input and metabolite concentration as an output, which is a good thing to have, because then a cell would not have to worry about varying enzyme levels. But still, that this relationship would be conserved. Okay, so now I hope that I could have showed you that eventually part of this adaptation from E. coli from growth to glucose and growth and acetate eventually involves flux sensing, yeah? And that this flux sensing is established via flux signaling metabolites, and that flux signaling metabolites are established via mechanisms like this. What I still have to show you is how actually now the whole adaptation would work. Yeah? Because this flux signaling and flux dependent regulation would be just part of it. Sorry? Now you ask. This fructose bisphosphate allosterically activates pyruvate kinase. But I don't remember whether this is a sigmoidal. No, I think it's a hill. It was a hill type. No, I don't really know. What the nature of this feedforward interaction, I don't know anymore. Well, this feed-forward is this metabolite. The level of this metabolite activates this enzyme. And in a way, intuitively, you could think about, when we push more flux through this, this increases, the concentration of this increases. And as it increases, it sort of starts to pull more here. And that's how I at least understand that this linear range is extended for a longer period of time. Yes, 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 exactly. So the second part is more or less, we have made a multiple enzyme cascade irreversible Michaelis-Menten. True, this is the second part. But that would not solve the problem that we get this linearity established beyond the Km value. And this linearity beyond the Km value is just something that we achieve with this feed-forward activation, where we sort of intuitively stretch the linear part.
That's what I want to know is if you just had the feed-forward part,
yep.
Like how does that plot look like with rate versus substrate? Is it already a linear plot without the reversible MM kinetics? So do you need both the paths? Because they're both...
I think we need an irreversible Michaelis-Menten type kinetic, and this could be spreading over multiple enzymes. Because if we would not have these irreversible things, a cell would need to measure the substrate concentration and the product concentration to infer something about the flux. And the irreversible Michaelis-Menten type thing, we need just that we can forget about the product concentration. Yeah, so what I had, this one here, yeah? If this is now an equation for a reversible Michaelis-Menten, yeah, we were just looking for something with this and this. So this is nasty, because in order to learn something about flux, we would also need to know the product concentration. And we only can get rid of by going through this. But then, if you plug in all these equations, we get an expression. This only being a function of flux and nothing else. This is what we need in order to just being able to measure one metabolite concentration and not two. Because if you would just rely on this, we wouldn't have to measure this one and this one to learn something about flux.
In principle, supposing there were not these multiple steps.
Yes.
But in a single step, that's reversible thing.
Then it would have.
There's a feed forward there. That is, if FBP were to sort of activate the enzyme that consumes it.
Yes. It probably would have to think about this, but more or less it would be the same, yeah?
Topologically, it would be the same.
Topologically, it would be the same, yeah. Whether it would work, that I could not tell immediately, but...
So that would be a minimal model, if you like, for this...
For establishing a flux signal.
Sensing metabolite.
Yes. Yes. Okay, now, the coming back to this question here, we now know that cells would establish flux signals, and that they eventually do regulation dependent on flux. But how does now the whole adaptation work? And here it turned, what we think the way it would work is that it would work with many global feedback loops. So I'll just walk you through this loop. So envision that there's now a carbon source being taken up and metabolic fluxes just happen in a passive way. These fluxes would then result in concentrations of flux signaling metabolites. Yeah, one of them I just showed you. This is also something that just happens. These flux signaling metabolites would activate transcription factor, would activate promoters. That promoters would result in protein production, would change enzyme concentration, and enzyme concentrations then establish flux. So you see, this is a very global feedback loop, where an important element in this feedback loop is actually the measurement of flux. So in a way, you can say flux is a control factor for metabolic regulation. And you could also boil it down to say flux controls flux. Yeah? So some fluxes happen and determine what the fluxes that happen in other pathways. And I guess you all would agree that feedback loops are great to adjust cells to new conditions. So that's how we think it works. And in fact, we think that all these four transcription factors that we had included here in this model would have would be regulated in a flux-dependent manner. And all these transcription factors are spread, are responding to flux signaling metabolites that are spread over metabolism. And in a way, you could now look at metabolism in such a way that at important crossroads, cells would have established flux signaling metabolites. And by just measuring flux at a few important crossroads, a cell could actually learn something about what kind of carbon source is currently flowing in. Envision you have a cell and would have established three flux signaling metabolites in the glycolytic pathway. One at the top, one at the middle, and one at the bottom. Well, if you're, if the first flux sensor says, oh, I don't see any carbon source, I don't see any flux, the second one says, I see flux, and the third one says, I see flux. So we're the biochemist, what kind of carbon source is flowing in? No biochemist here. So the first says no flux, the second one says yes flux, and the third one also says flux. Well, then it's glycerol that's flowing in. Glycerol enters in the middle of what if the first two say no flux, and the third one says I see flux? And it's probably pyruvate coming in, yeah? So this is the kind of logic that we think that E. coli has come up with in order to regulate its metabolism. And by just measuring at a few important points, it could infer what's actually currently flowing in. And I would argue it doesn't really matter for an E. coli cell to know whether malate or succinate is flowing in. Yeah, because malate are two TCA cycle intermediates. It doesn't really matter because both need to be metabolized in the same way. Yeah? So you can see by just using a few, measuring flux at a few points, a cell, and if you combine this flux information, the information from these flux signals, a cell could very easily learn something about the nature of the carbon source coming in. Furthermore, the problem that all people working in signaling often have is this issue of integration of signals. Yeah, you have different sensing systems, and all these signals stemming from these sensing systems would need to be integrated and combined, yeah, in a board computer of the cell. But here, it's actually very, very simple. If envision you have multiple carbon sources present at the same time, then the cell, what the cell is doing, it just responds to the flux that is happening in the cell. Yeah, so if two carbon sources are flowing in at the same time, they would eventually make an aggregate of these fluxes flowing in, and the cell would respond to this aggregate. So I would argue it's a much more simple system to regulate metabolism on the basis of flux that happens, because the signal integrator, quotation mark, is actually the integrated flux that happens. Furthermore, you don't need 100 different transmembrane sensors. Yeah, you just measure at a few points.
But then we know that in E. coli, there is a differential preference for lactose compared to glucose or other ways.
OK, now I put it for didactic purposes very black and white. And of course, it is not like black and white. There is the lac system. So that's something very specific. Yeah, and eventually, for some very specific carbon sources that would require specific uptake proteins and specific enzymes that would metabolize, then it would still make sense to have some specific sensors. Yeah, but for I would argue for something that is just something carbon sources that would correspond to metabolites that are anyhow in metabolism, there you don't need anything specific. What I would like to do in the last 20 minutes, well, first do a mid-summary. So cells measure metabolic flux at different positions, uses a control variable, and that flux sensors are integrated in global feedback loops, and I think we will find these feedback loops and these flux sensors in the core of metabolism You probably have seen this, that this has been proposed as the bow tie architecture of metabolism, where different things are flowing in, and here it's where it's going to be measured.
Over here, you also said, over here you showed us case where if you have a single metabolite and you have more reversible steps, then you have that irreversible step, then your metabolite concentration is something. So your example works out well. But if you have a system which has less number of these reversible steps, does the dynamics now become more, would there more possibility of change there? That the signal can be misread?
This also goes back to the earlier question. I would need to have some time to think about this. I could not tell spontaneously whether this is actually connected or not. Yeah. Okay, so let me quickly walk through the summary and then I'll open up at the end again. So I think it's probably an extremely smart design because we don't need these sensors necessarily. And I think it's also much more robust because it relies on measuring of what happens instead of relying on measuring of what eventually could be there. Yeah. And I think that the last thing is that would be an example that metabolism is not a dull workhorse, but in fact could be seen as an autonomous self-regulating system. Okay, so this is what I've just shown you. Yesterday I started off with comparing metabolism with streets and traffic. And also in streets and traffic, we have eventually systems that measure traffic, the density of the traffic, and then street signs would change according to traffic. So also in traffic, we have flux-dependent regulation. Okay, so the last few minutes, I will show you that this flux-dependent, flux signaling and flux-dependent regulation is not only exists in E. coli, but I would argue that this also exists in other organisms. And I would show you some relevance of this in the last few slides. So here we ask whether this flux-dependent regulation is also true in other organisms. And we're asking whether this is in yeast. So here we gathered lots of physiological data. And this physiological data is more or less the sugar uptake rate and the ethanol production rate. And we gathered this for different yeast strains, different sugar grown on different sugars, different condition, wild type and mutant strains. And what you see is that this is data from, I think, 40 different papers. And what you see is that this data, it really looks like as if this one would just be a function of this one here. So in order to really test this, we used a set of yeast strains that were all isogenic, well, had the same genotype, with the exception that the hexose transporter, so the protein that takes up glucose, had different affinities. So meaning that we had yeast strains where the glucose uptake was very limited, it was intermediary, and it was very high. And what we now could do is we could grow these strains on identical environments and ask what is actually happening. So with this perturbation, we just modulate the glucose influx rate. So first of all, we did flux analysis, so with 13C flux analysis as the one that I showed you yesterday. And this is the strain with the highest uptake rate, and this is the strain with the lowest uptake rate. And you don't need to be any expert, but you can see that these flux distributions are remarkably different. Yeah, they're completely different, although these cells are growing on exactly the same environment. So that this argues that indeed the way flux is being regulated inside the cell is flux dependent. And if you now took these five flux mutants, so we not only had three, but we had five of them, five with different glucose uptake rates. We grew wild type yeast on also different carbon sources. We did targeted proteomics where we probed the expression of 180 metabolic proteins. And we took these protein data and what we found is that more than 50% of the enzymes of core metabolism really correlated or anticorrelated with flux. That shows here with these Pearson correlation coefficients. So a number of them anticorrelated with flux and a number of them correlated with flux. And even if you take these protein expression data and just perform a hierarchical cluster analysis, what then turns out to be the fact is that these strains, although there's also strains that are grown in slightly different carbon sources, that they would just cluster along the glycolytic flux. And so that means that the protein expression would be largely flux dependent. So the proteome is dependent on glycolytic flux. So in a way that boils down to a model where we think that the rate of glucose influx, also here, it would be measured at some point, would go into some control thing, and then would sort of switch the valve between either cells respiring or cells fermenting. And the question is also here, is also this metabolite fructose bisphosphate the relevant one? So we performed metabolomics, the technique that I showed you yesterday. And it turns out that also here, fructose bisphosphate was the metabolite that correlated most with the rate through glycolysis. And surprise, surprise, this feed-forward activation that I just mentioned with E. coli is also present in yeast. So who knows? Maybe this is working in a similar way. And now let's take it one step further. And the same picture, the picture here that I illustrated here with fructose bisphosphate correlating with the rate of glycolysis is also true in mammalian cells. You probably know that cancer cells have high rates of glycolysis. And this is data from a cancer cell. You see that this metabolite here is very high versus in normal cells, it's very low. And also in mammalians, this feed-forward activation exists. Yes?
Are you saying that a quantitative
change in the influx of glucose here results through this sensing mechanism, a qualitative change in the internal organization? That is, you know, it's not merely that, you know, it's not just a quantitative change in the expression levels of the same proteins that were involved earlier, but just, you know, they go up to a higher level or lower level.
No, it's really a complete different picture. And probably the best, again, to illustrate this is that these fluxes cannot be more different. And the environment is the same. It's just a rate of influx. And it's not just that these fluxes are different, but the whole protein expression is different, which is shown here, which is, and the protein expression has what this shows is follows, is more or less, knowing the glycolytic flux, I could now with this tell you what is the protein expression.
So there is some kind of a switch involved. I mean, beyond the mechanism that you've told us about flux sensing metabolites.
Yep.
There has to be further a switch involved that at some point, you know, something.
Yes. No, it is like I see this as the input, the passive input that in this yeast example we sort of genetically engineered in order to be able to have the environment constant. But this is what happens to the cell. And now I argue that something here in glycolysis is being measured and used to make decisions on how protein expression happens and how the flux is further distributed. And I argue that such a flux sensor also here in yeast and in mammalian could be also this metabolite fructose 6 phosphate. Yeah, because it also correlates with flux. We see also this feed forward, which would be important to establish this. In mammalians, we see the same picture. If flux is high, then FEP is high. If flux is low, then FEP is low. Also in mammalians, this feed-forward activation of pyruvate kinase exists. Yeah? So I just see whatever we have learned in E. coli could eventually also be true in other organisms. So the question is now, in looking at yeast, how is this flux signal, yeah, if it's FEP, how is this being picked up by the regulatory machinery. In yeast, in E. coli, we had this transcription factor that would be interacting with this metabolite. Here, in yeast, we don't have no transcription factors known to interact with this. But there would be other possibilities for interactions. This metabolite could interact with enzymes, could interact with transcription factors, could modulate the activity of phosphatases, kinases. And in fact, if zooming in on FBP interactions with enzymes, there's indeed a few things are already known. But some recent work from the Picotti lab in Zurich, who came up with a spectacular mass spectrometric method to identify on a high throughput manner conformational changes of proteins with upon interaction with small molecules, she has found that all these enzymes here are presumably enzymes whose structures change upon increased or decreased levels of FBP. Yeah. So that could argue that if this is a flux signal, so that would have, this flux signal would have important consequences all over metabolism. And because this is just a high throughput, a very recent high throughput technology, we're never sure that it's actually all false positives. So we started to look into some of them. We picked out here hexokinase, did some detailed biochemical analysis, and could indeed find that there's conformational changes also on a really biochemical level, at least for one of them. So the question is now, is this all relevant, this flux sensing? I would say it's at least relevant if E. coli would, in the adaptation from E. coli from between different carbon sources, I would argue that it also is relevant in other organisms. And I would now, in the last few minutes, just walk you very quickly through to these points where I make links to what I would just have shown, but show that this is actually probably relevant in other occasions. So first of all, these topics. So you probably know that yeast is an organism that has a limited lifespan. And that means that with every daughter that, with every new bud that a yeast cell would produce, it gets older and older and older. And it's probably best shown you in this movie here, which is a movie obtained from a microfluidic device where cells, yeast mother cells, are attached on a microfluidic device, and through a continuous nutrient flow, daughters are constantly washed out. And if you follow this cell here, which is constantly producing buds, and if you follow this mother cell, you will see that it will get bigger and bigger and bigger, and at some point, very sadly, it would die. Huh? Very dramatic. And if you looked very closely, you had seen something, namely that this mother cell has really resemblance also to the phenotypes of human agings. Yeah, it got wrinkles, it got a bit bigger. Yeah. And if you would statistically plot this, determine the cell volume here as a function of time, you will see the cell grows bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, if this yeast cell grows bigger, its surface to volume ratio changes. What if its surface to volume ratio changes? Wouldn't that mean that the amount of glucose coming in per volume gets smaller? What if the volumetric flux gets smaller? And let's assume that flux is being measured in yeast. The flux signal, being eventually FBP, would drop. If it drops, what does the yeast cell do? It looks it up in the handbook. What do I have to do if my FBP drops? Oh, I have to respire. This is not my handbook, yeah? And what I mean with handbook is it's imprinted regulation machinery, yeah? So if everything is true, what I was just telling you, wouldn't we expect one additional phenotype of an aging yeast cell in response to this increased volume, wouldn't it need to be such that these yeast cells would need to switch to respiration once they get bigger? Of course, I would not tell you that if it would not happen. But indeed, this is a question that we had in the lab. This is what we inferred. So what we had to do is we had to actually determine the physiological rates of aged yeast cells. But this is an extreme problem because in a culture, we typically determine these rates by just probing the outside nutrient concentrations over a function of time. We first needed to get all aged yeast cells. But it's extremely difficult to get aged yeast cells because of the exponential growth. Yeah, every yeast cell makes a new daughter, and this is a young cell. So to get large amounts of aged yeast cells on the basis of which you could do physiological analysis, you first have to get these old yeast cells. And the way we got them is by coupling iron beads to these to a culture of yeast cells. So every yeast cell had now small iron beads attached to it. We put them onto a column, and this column we put it to a magnet. So these red things are now magnets, and the yeast cells are immobilized here, and we would put medium through it where we would constantly wash out the newly emerging daughter cells. So with this, we could really let yeast cells enrich and wash out the old daughter cells. And we had 16 of these columns in parallel, so that we could run them over multiple days and then just harvest one of these columns and more or less get aged yeast cells. This is shown here. After we had solved 1,000 different experimental problems, we got a way how we could produce large amount of HGLCs. And this is just showing you a bit of the setup. It was really a fun and nightmare experiment at the same time. The whole lab was actually busy in taking samples over 4 days all around the clock. And we had determined different omics analysis on these aged yeast cells, and also physiological analysis. And this is the result of this physiological analysis, what you see here. So this is yeast cells, different ages. So this is ours here. And this is the carbon yields. And what you see, this is for a young cell. And they produce, of course, most of it is ethanol. And as they age, they stop producing ethanol, and the carbon dioxide yield is increased, which would clearly indicate that they switch to respiration. And that's exactly like this. Yeah, where if the sugar influx rate, yeah, volumetric, would collapse, this signal would collapse. And then this is the handbook of the yeast cell where they say, oh, my flux is low. OK, I'll need to switch to respiration. OK, so that seems so we could explain here an important aging phenotype just by the fact that that aged yeast cells are getting bigger. The second example is actually what I go into tomorrow, is that this flux, I will show you tomorrow that this flux sensing can actually cause bistability. That goes back to your problem. So I will walk you through this story here. And the last point for those of you who are eventually engaged in metabolic engineering, yeah, so that's a discipline for where one would engineer cells in order to produce commercially interesting products. And the problem here is that when we do interventions that one would do in metabolic engineering is that one would overexpress genes, one would delete genes. All of this has as a target to redirect flux. Yeah, so this is inherent to metabolic engineering. Yeah, we would like to engineer cells that fluxes are being rerouted to the product. So it involves changing flux. And if you're not aware of the fact that cells sense flux and regulate flux in response to flux, what could happen? You could be hit through the back door. So you do an intervention to steer your fluxes to your desired product. But in fact, what the cell is trying to do, it's trying to do what it needs to do. And you would try to work against you. Yeah? So you could say this is very bad. But you could also say, hey, we are smart. Simply, we can use the fact, once we understand of how flux establishes flux signals, yeah, once we understand these black boxes, we can actually use them for us. So that we rather engineer here and then get the cells to automatically do what we want them to do. Okay, 1 minute left. It's just about for the summary. So I showed you that metabolic phenotype is largely dependent on metabolic flux. Metabolic flux is sensed and used for regulation, and a flux sensing is integrated in global feedback loops. Thank you very much for your attention.
So also this the oldest cell, the oldest mother cell kept becoming bigger and bigger. Does it also happen in E. coli?
Also, E. coli cells have been shown to be able to get older, and the way that it was shown is if you have an E. coli cell, and now just follow this hand, yeah, it divides and divides, gives a new cell, yeah?
Yes.
Gives a new cell. So this pole stays the same. So this is how it has been shown that also E. coli can get older.
Yeah.
But I'm not aware of the fact that really the size would get...
Yes, and the second part that it kept aging, right? So what molecularly aging means? I mean, what exactly was happening?
Well, some things this were not is what able people are trying to find out. So what is this aging? Why are they only producing a limited number of cells? No, nobody really knows. There's tons of theories out there. But there's, I guess, not a good account of what's happening. People are just still busy with finding out what are actually aging phenotypes. Yeah, and one of them I showed you. No, two of them I showed you here. I showed you that yeast cells get bigger as they age. I showed you that they switch their metabolism. Other things are known as well. People have studied, found certain intervention to prolong lifespan or to shorten lifespan.
Yeah, but why did they get bigger when they kept on aging? I mean, yep. Why? No, okay.
Nobody knows.
Some people think that they keep their vacuoles.
Yeah, if you look very closely to this movie, this was actually a vacuole protein that was used here. So the fluorescence that you see comes from a vacuole protein. So you see that initially vacuoles are relatively small, but already after a few generations, yeah, out of the total 30, it's already relatively big, but it still continues to grow in size. It's probably hard to see the fluorescence.
I actually have one clarification that, you know, in case of E. coli, it kind of regulates the diameter, right? It only grows in... Okay, so the question is that in E. coli, it kind of maintains the diameter and grows in length, right? So the surface to volume ratio stays constant there. So the problem doesn't even come in to the picture in E. coli, right? Because the flux is going to be more or less same, right?
Well, it is such that the type of carbon source that E. coli grows on determines the growth rate. And now I need to be cautious and Well, at least there seems to be a relation between growth rate and length.
Okay, yeah.
And there seems to be a correlation between type of carbon source and growth rate.
Yes.
How this all is established?
You saw that the glycolytic flux is regulating the expression of the metabolic proteins. Can it regulate the expression of other proteins?
Yes. For the yeast case where we looked at them, we had looked at 180 different metabolic proteins. And these were more or less the enzymes of central metabolism. And 50% of them were... I'm not sure whether I answer your question.
No, I want to know, can it regulate expression of other proteins that are not involved in metabolism?
FEP?
Yes, or any other these metabolites.
I think we're just about starting to understand this. So this is what came out from this high throughput study, FEP, and all these black printed enzymes here are...
These are metabolic.
These are all metabolic enzymes. Yeah, there were five more proteins that this study has uncovered that were non-metabolic proteins. But I should say that eventually there's an experimental bias to this, because metabolic proteins are typically fairly abundant. So this is why this study eventually primarily has just picked up enzymes as targets for FEP. So I would not attempt to drawing a conclusion that it also only regulates metabolic things.
Go back to the summary slide. So, uh, So isn't everything that has been shown today is just another way of saying that if you have a, say, bistable system already, say mutual repressor which gives bistability, and it has a high Hill coefficient so that there is a sharp transition between the two states, then the concentration of the transcription factors will determine whether it's in the low state or the high state. And your flux is basically the concentration which is being detected by the operator site, by the transcription binding site. So your flux is basically this concentration, and your switching between the two states is because of two stable states being possible. It looks like just another way of saying the same thing.
Well, here I haven't mentioned anything on bistability. I would here rather argue that it's here a graded response.
Yeah, you can have multistable system. I think you can construct a multistable system, and depending on the transcription factor concentrations, maybe you can switch between depending on how much concentration you have. Bistable is the simplest way of getting two states, but I think it will be impossible to construct a multistable system.
I'm not sure whether I fully get your point.
The point is, suppose you have a two state, you are showing the valve switching between respiratory and fermentation state.
Well, yeah, but this valve is also not just like here or here, but it could also go like this, yeah? Everything in between, it would also be allowed. So that's what I'm saying, it's more a graded response.
Yeah, but gradient response you can get in this kind of Hill function also if the Hill coefficient is not very high. So if the Hill coefficient is 2 or 1, you can get a gradient response there also. But point is that the flux which we are talking about is basically the concentration which is being required for synthesis of a protein.
Well, here the flux that we most talked about is the glycolytic flux. And of course, this is sort of the main carbon route, and carbon is taken from there to synthesize protein. But I rather argue that the cells make decisions of how this carbon is being metabolized on the basis of the flux through glycolysis.
So the transcription factor which comes out of as a measure of the flux,
yep,
that then comes into as a concentration dependence which will regulate.
Yes. Yes.
It's like one step going even farther and seeing what determines this concentration of transcription factor.
The metabolite, the flux signal metabolite, is the level here. And usually it's us looking at this and making decisions on the basis of what the flux would be. And the transcription factor is the one who is looking at this and is making then decisions.
So at this point, let's say in E. coli, do you have an estimate of how many flux-sensing metabolites there are, A? And B, where in the metabolic network are they located? So you mentioned this bow tie structure, and I think you briefly mentioned that this stuff is in the central part, in the central bow. Yes. And might there be such things outside in the two ties or whatever it is? So.
No, I think this is a very good question, because of course you can imagine that we're currently looking into this. What are flux signaling metabolites? Where are they situated? What is the topology around them? And so, so there's multiple approaches to do that. One approach is to perturb flux in different manners. So and then measure flux and measure metabolite levels and look for correlations. The problem with that is that measuring fluxes, and I didn't tell you the full truth yesterday, is very complicated, particularly if you go to non-glucose substrates. Then current technology isn't really very good. So an approach of just go and perturb fluxes in the most diverse way, measure them, measure metabolites at the same time, and looking for correlation is probably not the way to go. It's one way, but probably not the smartest way. What we're currently doing, we think we just harbor information that is out there in the literature by screening, getting as much information as possible on enzyme, on protein, small molecule interactions across organisms. And those metabolites that occur most often as such interactions are probably metabolites that are flux signaling metabolites. So we did that. We got a number of metabolites that are, occur most often in such interactions. And the other thing that we did is we took metabolomics data and asked which metabolites are most dynamic across conditions, across perturbations. Because also those metabolites that are most dynamic are probably those that sort of are flux signals. And it turns out if you take these two data sets and map them on top of each other, it's almost a perfect match. So that is a suggestion for what could other flux signaling metabolites be. And we have one other candidate in the pentose phosphate pathway. And the next thing to do now is to look what is sort of the regulation topology around these flux signals. Are they the same as what we had here for fructose-based phosphate? So that's how we move forward.
So when you started with the initial model, there you do not have a flux sensing inbuilt into the model, right?
We probably had, but we were not aware of it. Exactly. No, I think you're phrasing this very well. Yeah. So what we had, of course, put in CRA, CRA, the transcription factor, and we put in an interaction between FBP. That is what we had put in. But we had not put in the flux sensing is, as you said it, is the emergent thing that came out. And then once we had this, and once we had simulated this model back and forth and back and forth, you say, hey, isn't that what is going on here? So in a way, it is we started completely naive, just putting biochemistry in. Yeah? And I would like to connect it back to the hypothesis that we had. The hypothesis, can we find a subset of molecular mechanisms that can do that? Apparently we could. And now retrospectively say, hey, this is how it goes. So now the model is not interesting to us anymore. It was just a stepping stone towards sort of understanding of how this biological system works, and now we continue from that. And yeah, but I didn't let you actually answer your question.
Just an additional part of it. Now that you know that metabolic sensing, flux sensing is involved, and you also have this new data which says that flux sensing can alter the rates of some enzymes. Would including that in the model now give you some additional insight?
I'm coming back to his question that he had asked, yeah, on the allosteric interactions that are there. I would now dare to classify allosteric small molecule enzyme interactions in two different classes. The one class being the downstream response of a flux signal. I'll go back to. These are all enzymes that presumably are activated or inhibited with fructose-based phosphate. And I would say that if it's really such that FEP activates or inhibits these enzymes, then these are allosteric interactions that are downstream, yeah, that exert an action. But there's probably also the other type of allosteric interactions that are part of this system that establishes the flux signal, which is this feed-forward interaction. Yeah? So some of these interactions, some of these allosteric interactions, I would say, are part of the system that establishes the flux signal. And other allosteric interactions are probably those that exert action of the flux signal.